Good evening. Today's seminar topic is anorectal malformations, the surgical options available for definitive management. Introduction to the topic. Anorectal malformations present a wide spectrum of anomalies, and the classification of the types both in males and females have already been discussed. Different defects require different therapeutic approach and carry different prognosis. So the goal of anorectoplasty primarily is to reconstruct the malformation anatomically to achieve fecal continence without damaging the nervi erigentis and to have an aesthetic appearance of the neoanus, which is situated in the center of the sphincter muscle complex. So with changing concepts in our understanding of the muscular anatomy and the continence determinants, there have been evolution of procedures through time. This, however, it still stands that no single major procedure is able to achieve all necessary goals without problems in the treatment of anorectal malformations. We'll briefly review the muscular anatomy of the anorectal region, which has already been discussed earlier. In this diagram, we can see the levator ani muscle here, which composes of the iliococcygeus and the ischiococcygeus. B, over here, labeled as B, is the pubococcygeus muscle. This is the puborectalis sling shown here. D is the upper deep part of the external sphincter, and E is the superficial part of the external sphincter. The uppermost part of the deep part of external sphincter and the puborectalis share some common fibers. And this shows the muscular anatomy. The external sphincter is a complex structure which extends from the skin to the levator ani region, and it is there are multiple septations. It divides into strata, and it is anchored anteriorly to the perineal body and posteriorly to the coccyx and the skin. So in this we can see the internal sphincter, which is an expanded part of the circular muscles of the rectum. We'll first go through the classic and conventional procedures which were described for especially for intermediate and high ARM. Initially, in the early 1800s, there were formal perineal proctoplasty was first described, followed by anal transposition technique. And in the early 1900s, single-stage abdominoperineal procedures were widely used. One such procedure is the Rhodes procedure, which was described in 1948, which entailed pelvic dissection of the blind pouch of the rectum by an abdominal approach, rectourethral fistula transection and closure, followed by pull-through of the rectum through the perineum. However, this was not a very accurate procedure. It had high risk of damage to the autonomic nerves and difficult access to fistulas by abdominal approach, especially when they are lower. So then came the description in 1953 by Stephens of a procedure which emphasized on the preservation of puborectalis muscle for continence. This was a sacroperineal or sacroperineoabdominal rectoplasty. This had entailed a short sacrococcygeal incision. The plane of the puborectalis was defined by a right angle forceps, as shown here, against a metal sound which is placed within the urethra or vagina, and the fistula is ligated from within the rectum. So this is how it looks after the procedure. The rectum is mobilized via sacral or in higher fistulas via abdominal incisions and threaded down the puborectalis sling, and anoplasty is done. So the advantages of this procedure is that it stresses on the essentiality of puborectalis. No extra rectal dissection is done and bladder nerve supply is protected, unlike the Rhodes procedure. The anus is skin lined and sensation, and hence sensation is preserved. This also permits tapering of rectum if necessary, and it is suitable for reoperations. However, difficulties in, that we encounter include poorer exposure, and puborectalis may not always be well visualized, and it can the pull through can diverge from the midline, even the dissection when we do it blindly. There's restricted access to the fistula and urethra, and external sphincter complex is penetrated blindly. So early results, they reported 68% of continence in intermediate and high ARM, that is the early series of Stephens and Smith. The other abdominal rectoplasty that was later described as a modification of Stephens was abdominal approach to define correct plane through the puborectalis sling. So feeding of the neorectum was done via abdominal approach through the sling to the perineum. This attempted to define the puborectalis sling and provide adequate mobilization and allow tapering and excision of megarectum if required. However, even in this procedure, it was difficult to define puborectalis and involved pararectal dissection. Possible damage to urethra and nerves risk was there, and it did not define the external sphincter. Many modifications of Stephen's procedure were being performed up until 1980s. This is another combination of which is Stephen's key sweater and Rehbeen, which is described in 1967. That is the sacroabdominoperineal rectoplasty with a submucosal resection. In this, the new rectum is brought down or pulled through a demucose sleeve of the original rectum. So this is how the rectal pouch is demucosed. Perineal canal through the puborectalis sling is defined by bidigital palpation as shown here. And then similar to Stephen's procedure, we can the bowel is pulled down. It is pulled down, the colon above is pulled down through a denuded area of rectal pouch as shown here. In this, this also stresses on essentiality of puborectalis with no extra rectal dissection, permitting tapering of bowel. Accurate identification of fistula was attempted in this technique, and megarectum in the distally, the distal rectal pouch can be bypassed, especially when it is inert, it is advantageous. And disadvantages, puborectalis definition again continued to be blind, and this sacrifices potential efference from the rectum distally, which is not used, and it does not define the external sphincter. This procedure is contraindicated in low IRM without a fistula. Then the anterior perineal rectoplasty was described by Mollard. In this, a curved transverse perineal incision is taken anterior to the expected site of the neoanus, and this is used to approach the sphincter complex. So the plane to the fistula and the puborectalis is opened up through this incision, and abdominal portion of the operation is done by the submucosal sleeve dissection technique of Rehbeen, which I just described earlier. So the modification in this is mainly with respect to the incision and usage of the skin flap. Advantages are good exposure and identification of the puborectalis and protection of urethra. There is no pararectal dissection involved. Disadvantages are that, again, external sphincter is not fully visualized, prolapse rate is too high, and it is known to cause a very acute anorectal angle and possible damage to the urethral nerve supply. So in 1980, there was a new concept with different where De Vries and Pina felt that there was too much emphasis on placed on the value of puborectalis incontinence, and they shifted the focus towards the sphincter muscle complex. So in this, they described the posterior sagittal anorectoplasty with this concept. The dissection is aided by electrostimulation of all the muscle fibers which are involved in the sphincter muscle complex. So a precise definition of the maximum confluence of the external sphincter components can be done at the proposed anal site. And each muscle is divided in the sagittal plane in exact midline. So the combined D part of external sphincter and puborectalis complex are divided. This provides wide access to divide a fistula under vision and mobilize and taper the terminal rectum. And then reconstitution of all the muscle elements is done accurately around the new rectum and in precisely correct anatomic position. So the advantages of this procedure were that it gives accurate identification of all muscles, good exposure of the fistula, protection of nerves and urethra, and prevents prolapse. Disadvantages, damage, possible damage to the divided muscles. It underplays the role of puborectalis and overplays tapering. There is higher incidence of tapering, and no skin line anus is done is present after anoplasty. Another modification which came up, which is essentially a combination of De Vries's and Pina's posterior sagittal exposure with Rehbeen submucosal dissection, is the Yokoyama procedure. In this, via perineal approach, puborectalis complex is defined but not divided, and via abdominal approach, the fistula is accessed. The advantages, and then under vision, the neorectum is tunneled as shown here. The advantages is, again, this has no extra rectal dissection, preserves internal sphincter. The puborectalis is not disturbed and utilizes the external sphincter as explained by the PACIP concept. And disadvantages is it limits access to the fistula and query placement through the external sphincter again is not very accurate. Following this, the next description was by Durham. This is a combination of Stephen's stress on puborectalis, the key sweater rehbin submucosal sleeve dissection, the Mullard's anterior approach, Pena's exposure of PSARP, Yokoyama's use of internal sphincter in the repair, and skin-lined anus, which is derived from Nixon's anoplasty. All these concepts and procedures were combined and described by Durham Smith to achieve an ideal rectoplasty. In the perineal rectoplasty, the levator ani diaphragm is divided, superficial external sphincter is divided, the puborectalis and deep part of sphincter are retained, the fistula is divided from within the bowel, and the bowel is mobilized and tapered if necessary, and this bowel is brought through an undamaged sling, that is the puborectalis sling, and the levator ani and external sphincter are reconstituted as in the PSARP procedure, and Nixon lined anoplasty is done to provide skin lined anus. The Nixon's anoplasty is done as shown here. Incisions in the perineum are given, two kite-shaped areas of skin. They are excised, and each edge of the incision, as shown here, is sutured after rotating by 180 degrees to the circumference end of the bowel. Post-operative image is shown here. So by closing these flaps, we create a skin-lined anus. The MOPE procedure is another modification where Mullard-Pena procedure. It adds the benefit of an anoplasty based on the original flap that was described by Mullard, that is the anterior curved transverse incision. This is slightly modified as shown in this diagram, and the central skin defect which is present after the flap is closed by rotating laterally. Lateral perineal skin is rotated to close it. So this provides good cosmesis and is easier to perform. Currently the most commonly practiced technique and the most popular is the posterior sagittal approach. We'll discuss in detail the basic principles and its application in male and female ARM specific defects. The prerequisite before the procedure, as in any of the rectoplasty procedure, is to review the high pressure distal cologram. This has been described earlier. The position is prone. Use of electrical stimulator is done to assess contraction of the sphincter muscle complex to guide with precision the midline dissection. The length of the incision depends on the type of defect. Small incisions are used for like rectovestibular fistulas, and very small incisions may be used for perineal fistulas. Depth also depends on the type of defect, and the need to expose levator ani depends on the defect. Separation of the rectum from the urogenital structure in this procedure is the most delicate and crucial step, and then we can assess need for tapering. This diagram shows the classical PSRP incision, and this may be limited to the anterior part of the sphincter muscle complex depending on the kind of fistula. And this shows the exposure after splitting, maintaining an exact midline, the parasagittal fibers on either side. In rectoperineal fistulas, which is a low defect, the rectum is mostly within the sphincter muscle complex. Only the lowermost part of the rectum is anteriorly mislocated and with the fistula opening into the perineum or subepithelial midline tract and opening along the midline raphe in males and base of penis. It is diagnosed by inspection, and opening is not normal anal canal. That is, there will not be any anal columns. It is a fistula and is mostly stenotic. Externally, it manifests as covered anus, bucket handle or bucket handle malformation. So with the prone position, multiple 6-0 sill sutures are taken at the fistula orifice, and incision dividing the sphincter muscle complex posterior to the fistula is done, and the posterior rectal wall is visualized. Lateral dissection is done, followed by anterior rectal dissection, which is most critical to avoid urethral injury. And the common wall has no plane of dissection. Two walls have to be created out of one. In the rectourethral fistulas males, there are two types, the rectourethrobulbar fistula, which is lower, and the rectourethroprosthetic fistula. In the bulbar fistula, there will be good quality muscles, well-developed sacrum, and prominent midline groove with a good anal dimple. And in rectoprosthetic fistulas, poor quality muscles are seen with abnormal sacrum, flat perineum, and a poor midline groove. So this is the most common defect in males, and above the fistula site, there will be a common wall between the rectum and urethra. The rectum is distended and surrounded laterally and posteriorly by the levator inii muscle. And between the perineum and the skin, the sphincter muscle complex will be present. At the skin level, we can see the parasagittal fibers on either side of the midline. Initially, at the start of the procedure, catheterization difficulties are noted. 20% chance is there for the catheter to go into the rectum. And we'll have to recatheterize under direct visualization with a scope or in the catheter is threaded over a guide wire. Incision, as already described, and division of the parasagittal fibers, muscle complex, and levator muscle is done. In the midline, coccyx may be split, especially in higher fistulas like rectoprosthetic fistulas. Silk sutures are placed on either side of the rectal wall, either side of the midline, and rectum is open in the midline, and then it is incised downwards towards the fistula site distally. Stase sutures are taken over the fistula site, and rectal mucosa is dissected above the fistula site. The rectum is separated from the urethra, a submucosal plane is created anteriorly towards the fistula site, and we dissect up to 5 to 10 mm above the fistula site. The lateral dissection is carried out first, followed by anterior dissection, which makes the anterior dissection easier. So in this fashion, circumferential perirectal dissection is done close to the rectal wall to gain adequate rectal length. So this should give us a tension-free rectoperineal anastomosis. So we stay close to the rectal wall to avoid denervation injury to the neighboring structures and to provide good mobilization. Uniform traction has to be given so that we can identify bands and vessels that are holding the rectum in the pelvis and they can be selectively divided. We then assess the size of the rectum in comparison to the space available for it to be pulled through within the muscle complex, and if necessary, tapering is done. Tapering has to be done in the posterior wall of the blind pouch, and it is sutured in two layers with a delayed absorbable suture. The urethral fistula is sutured. Smooth muscles are reinforced anteriorly between the urethral fistula and the rectum, and anteriorly the perineal body reconstruction is done. Again, we use electrically, we determine the limits of the sphincter muscle complex as we would have marked in the beginning of the surgery with temporary skin sutures. The crossing of the longitudinal and parasagittal fibers in the depth will show the limits of the sphincter, usually mark the limit of the sphincter muscle complex. The rectum is placed precisely within the sphincter muscle complex limits. The posterior edge of the levator inii and posterior limits are reapproximated posteriorly, as shown here. And we also take the posterior stitches, take a few bites over the rectal wall for it to stay in place. And anoplasty is done with 16 interrupted delayed absorbable sutures, as shown here. And then the wound is closed. Rectobladder neck fistula is seen in about 10% of the males, which is a high ARM. It opens at the bladder neck. It carries poor prognosis because the levator inii and sphincter muscles are poorly developed and associated usually with caudal regression. The sacrum and pelvis will be deformed and underdeveloped. In this similar posterior sagittal incision is used that division of muscles is done. Laparotomy or laparoscopy will be required as an additional approach to access the fistula site, which is present about 2 cm below the peritoneal reflection. The rectum opens usually perpendicularly into the bladder, and higher the malformation, shorter the common channel, which makes the dissection easier. Laparoscopic approach in these cases provide excellent visualization. This we'll be discussing later. So the serosa covering the distal moat part of the rectum is divided, and plane of dissection is reached between around the rectum. The fistula is then ligated, and rectum mobilization is done to gain adequate length and pull through to the perineum. In imperforate anus without fistula, there'll be well-developed sacrum with good muscles and good prognosis for bowel function. Very thin common wall will be present between urethra and rectum. 50% of the cases without a fistula usually have Down syndrome. They have to be screened for that. And more than 90% Downs with ARM have no fistula. A careful common wall dissection is required in this, as there is a thin common wall. Rectal atresia and stenosis is an extremely unusual anomaly seen in 1% of male ARM. The upper pouch is dilated, and the lower pouch, there is a lower portion has a small Anencolon which is present at the normal site. So they are separated by thin or dense membrane or by fibrous tissue. The narrow area is usually 1 to 2 cm deep from the anal verge. This has excellent functional prognosis as there is a normal development of voluntary sphincters. This can be approached by posterior sagittal incision, and end-to-end anastomosis is done of the upper rectal pouch and the short distal anal canal. In females, rectoperineal fistula is similar as described earlier in males. Here we dissect the rectal pouch off the posterior vaginal wall instead of the urethra, and complete mobilization is vital, as incomplete mobilization can cause retraction of the pull-through or dehiscence of the perineal body. Rectovestibular fistula, it forms the most common defect in females. It carries excellent functional prognosis. A third orifice is visualized in the vestibule posterior to the normal vagina. Then this is how we can make the diagnosis. And about 5% of them can have hemivaginas with a visible septum. This can be repaired without protective colostomy. Usually can be done as a neonatal primary operation, that is single stage surgery. So this can avoid morbidity of colostomy, reduce the number of surgeries, but can have higher infection rate, dehiscence, and recurrent fistula, and which may cause severe fibrosis and lead to suboptimal functional results. In the rectovestibular fistula, we follow similar posterior sagittal approach with a shorter incision. Multiple sutures are taken at the mucocutaneous junction of the fistula. The sphincter muscle is divided, posterior rectum is visualized, covering fascia removed, and dissection is done close to the rectal wall as described earlier, and rectum is separated from the vagina. This will have a long common channel, and the dissection has to continue till areolar tissue is seen between the vagina and rectum. Then perineal body repair is important anteriorly, and muscle complex reconstruction is done posteriorly, and anoplasty is done. So common post-op care in all these PSARP cases will be retaining the Foley catheter for 7 days, IV antibiotics for 48 hours, antibiotic ointment application in perineum for about 7 days. Anal dilatation is initiated 2 weeks post-repair, twice daily initially, and weekly increase in size of dilator. And then the frequency is also decreased, and we reach to a desired size of dilatation. And the size of dilator is, the desired size will vary with age, usually about up to 4 months, number 10. And most infants within up to 14 dilator is used. Colostomy closure can then be planned. Constipating diet is recommended if multiple bowel movements and occurs and with excoriation. And later on, OPBC we assess the functional outcomes, which include voluntary bowel movements, soiling, and constipation. This will be discussed in detail in subsequent classes. And we'll now discuss the anterior sagittal anorectoplasty, which is described for rectovestibular and perineal fistulas. It was first described in 1992 by Okada. He described it as a less invasive procedure compared to PSARP. The brief description is that in lithotomy position, anterior portion of the sphincter muscle is cut through a medial perineal incision as shown here, and rectum is pulled through the center of the muscles to gain a normal opening. So the procedure that we follow right now is the ASARP. Patient is supine with squatting or lithotomy with elevation of low back. The site of the new anus is again marked by electrical stimulation. Vestibular opening is gradually dilated with Hecker's dilators. A vertical midline incision is taken as shown here, extending from the fistula site to the center of the muscle complex, which is marked here. Circumferential 4-0 silk stay sutures are taken at the mucocutaneous junction of the anal opening, and packing of the anus may be done by sterile gauze. Circumferential incision around the anal opening is continued. The rectal wall is then carefully separated from the posterior vaginal wall by alternating sharp and blunt dissection, really at the posterior lateral points initially, and then anterior dissection, and until full separation we dissect. Mobilization of the rectal pouch is continued till it reaches the neoanus site without tension, and rectum is placed in the center of the muscle complex and anchored using 4 delayed absorbable sutures. So posterior fourchette is recreated, and the perineal body is reconstructed anteriorly, and perineal skin is closed. So comparing ASARP with PACRP, ASARP has better cosmesis. Wang et al. Early reports showed 15.4% constipation of ASARP. PACRP had higher incidence of post-op constipation. The original Pena and Levitt reports included about 55% of constipation. Also, good continence rate is seen after ASARP, about 97.6%, and Pena reported about 90% continence in post-PACRP at the age of 3 years. Other techniques that are described as for rectovestibular fistulas are described next. ASARP and PSRP both involve division of the sphincter muscles and the perineal skin, and problems related to these may cause problems related to fecal continence and possible perineal wound complications. So these are alternatives which tend to preserve the sphincter muscles and the perineal skin. One is the neutral sagittal approach, which incision extends from the coccyx to the anterior limit of the external sphincter and the perineal skin is intact. The transfistula anorectoplasty, sphincter-saving anorectoplasty, and transsphincteric anorectoplasty, also known as the anal transposition. The neutral sagittal anorectoplasty was described in 2005. It's a modified procedure especially for vestibular fistula. It preserves a bridge of perineal skin between the neoanus and the posterior fochet, and the levator ani muscle and the levator muscle is also preserved. So incision is from coccyx to anterior limit of the sphincter muscle complex, and an artery forceps is passed through the vestibular fistula to facilitate its location and exposure of rectum, and this is how the dissection is done, and this is the skin that is preserved. The advantages: it has better cosmesis, perineal body not divided, and can be performed as single stage. Disadvantage is that scar contraction can happen anteriorly, especially, and anterior migration of neoanus can happen. Transsphincteric anorectoplasty: in this, the vestibular fistula is mobilized, completely separated from the vaginal wall, and transposed within the muscle complex and external sphincter to the site of new anus via separate incision. This also preserves the skin bridge between the new anus and the posterior fochet and does not disturb the perineal body. And this also gives better cosmesis and higher continence rates are reported, but also higher constipation rates are noted. Sphincter saving anorectoplasty. This is another described technique in which similar to Stephen's principle, they're attempting to make it more precise. Pre-procedure, the center of the external sphincter on the anal dimple is marked using a muscle stimulator, and a 16 gauge cannula is advanced through the center of the external sphincter to lie just before the below the levators under USG guidance as shown here. And then a cannula is brought out. This needle is advanced in the midline towards the coccyx. A cannula is then brought out just below the last palpable, that is just below the coccyx or the last palpable vertebral bone, through this site. So a soft guide wire is passed, and that is the position of it is confirmed by doing a CT. All this is done preoperatively, and then intraoperatively, child is placed in prone jackknife position. A transverse skin incision is made just above the coccyx. Coccygectomy is done to aid exposure, and rectal blind pouch is mobilized and opened longitudinally, and a similar dissection is done. Separation from the urethra or vagina fistula site is closed, and the path of guide wire as shown here. This is the pre-operatively placed guide wire from the new anus site to up to the coccyx region, and then the path is serially dilated by Hegar's dilators, and rectal pull-through is done, and a standard anoplasty is done. So this is the post-operative approach. This will be the initial incision and perineal incision. So this sacral skin incision is not given in this. One-stage repairs without preliminary colostomy have been described, especially for rectovestibular fistula in females, as a safe approach. It avoids colostomy morbidity, done as early as possible in the neonatal period, as the results of the procedure in neonatal age are excellent. Maybe because of early development of brain defecation reflex and lesser incidence of postoperative complication. And it is also consistent with theories of early use of neoanus to train the perineal muscles and synapses and neural networks of the brain defecation reflex. Last topic will be laparoscopy assisted anorectal pull through, which is the latest development. Laparoscopy was popularized by Georgeson for abdominal dissection in anorectal malformation repairs. The goals will be to avoid dividing and weakening of the external sphincters, diminish perirectal scarring, precise placement of rectum through the sphincters, and potential, and it also presents as a potential primary procedure avoiding colostomy. This is done by standard, this is done following, which is describing following standard proximal sigmoid colostomy done in the neonatal period. About 2 to 4 months, LARP can be planned. Position transverse, child is placed transversely at the end of the table. Periurethral catheterization with or without aid of cystoscopy is done. Pneumoperitoneum is created. The trocar placement is as shown here. 4 mm trocar in the anterior axillary line just below the liver is the first port placed. 5 mm port is placed at the umbilicus by open technique, and another working port 3 or 4 mm in the anterior axillary line just above the anterior superior iliac spine to provide good triangulation. Laparoscopic rectal dissection is done at the peritoneal reflection, and mesorectum is divided with a hook. Circumferential dissection is carried out down to the rectourethral or rectovesical fistula, and loop ligature of the fistula has been described proximal to the entry into the urinary tract after clamping, dividing, and then a second ligature also is placed. So rectum is retracted out of the pelvis. We can with the laparoscopic visualization, pubococcygeus muscle, this is how the visualization will look. Pubococcygeus, the entire levator diaphragm can be well visualized, including the pubococcygeal sling. And then this will be the pull-through site, which can be delineated. So transperineal dissection is then carried out after mapping of the sphincters, as we do in PSIRP. The area of maximal contraction is marked, and a 1 cm vertical, that is a small incision, is made. The intersphincteric plane is then dissected below the level of levator ani. We can use either radially expanding trocar over a Veres needle, which is advanced between the bellies of the pubococcygeus in the midline. This will be aided by laparoscopy and is done just posterior to the urethra. The tract is usually dilated up to shown here 10 to 12 mm, and then the rectal fistula is grasped with a trocar and pulled down to the perineum, and anastomosis is completed at the perineum. And also laparoscopically, hit stitches have to be taken to the rectum to avoid mucosal prolapse. The fistula ligation, other options other than suture ligation, cystoscopy assistance can be used, and fistula. Also, some authors described non-ligation of the fistula. They do not ligate, and periurethral catheter may be left in situ for 14 days. And then the child is reassessed with an ultrasound and MCUG at follow-up. Other popular description is use of endoloops and endoclips, as shown here. This is a suture ligation to ligate the fistula. Advantages of LARP include relatively small incision, faster return of bowel function, lesser adhesions, shorter hospital stay, and use of laparoscopy for colostomy creation also has been described, which helps visualize the proximal sigmoid colon and retain a skin bridge between the colostomy and mucous fistula. The sigmoid bowel is divided only at the corner of the mucous fistula and matured through a separate stab incision. There are some specific unique complications to laparoscopic associated renorectoplasty. One such is the retained remnant of original fistula roof. The retained remnant can cause urinary tract infections, difficulty with catheterization, stone formation in the retained segment, mucus from the urethra, mucus discharge from the urethra, post-void dribbling, incontinence, and also potential oncologic risk because of mucosal irritation. This can be diagnosed with the combination of micturating cystourethrogram and an MRI. Another complication is inadvertent overmobilization of the rectum, which can compromise its blood supply and lead to long segment rectal strictures. And rectal prolapse can occur, and this is prevented, as described earlier, by taking hit stitches or U-stitch to the presacral fascia to tack the rectum in place. Some of the newer developments in laparoscopic anorectoplasty include precise ligation of the fistula and improved placement by using MRI-assisted laparoscopic anorectoplasty. In this, intraoperative repositioning is done with a special equipment. Intraop of cystoscopy, as already described earlier, can be done, especially during fistula ligation, so that flush ligation is done, so that there is no remnant, which is a complication that I just described. 5 mm staplers also have been described for dividing fistula, and good early results have been good. But potential risks are the staplers may partially extrude into the urinary tract and become potential nidus for stone formation and lead to infection. Sorry. Laparoscopy versus the conventional PSA-RP. There's been a study on that and comparing both of these. They report equal centrality of the pull-through segment within the muscle complex. The sphincter symmetry and irregularity seems greater with PSA-RP. A higher development of anorectal reflex is known with the laparoscopic procedure and better eventual continence. However, both of them have similar resting anal pressures. Higher rectal compliance is seen in laparoscopic assisted procedure. However, long-term follow-up is needed for assessment of continence in these procedures. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vidya. That was quite a comprehensive and compilation of the procedures for anorectal malformation.
Thank you, sir.
As regarding to just a couple of questions before this one, is there any single stage which is described by Indian author and which has been being done? One group does it routinely as a single stage, even for male. You said female, yes, in the neonatal period. Anything which has been described and papers are there mentioning the same? Single stage procedure for anorectal malformation?
No, sir.
From BHU, the
yes,
team
yes,
from
yes,
BHU.
Yes, I went through an Advanced article. One of the authors is from Banaras Hindu University, but overall it is described in, it's a paper from Bangladesh.
No. It is for Dr. Gangopadhyay and Chudamani Gopal. They have described a long series, but of course, the outcomes and that needs to be assessed.
Okay, sir.
As far as your PSRP and LARP. Now, regarding for surgeries for anorectal malformation itself, PSRP versus the other long term which has been used is sacroperineal approach by Durham Smith and Stephen modification.
Yes.
So, what is the reports like outcomes for intermediate and high? Is there any which is seen, or is it only available for PSRP?
For intermediate and high, the abdominosacroperineal procedures which are described earlier have better outcomes compared to PSA-RP.
So what is a single thing that Dr. Pinai introduced that changed? So technique wise, so seen so many techniques, so they all went around splitting, non-splitting, one group of insisting on the maintenance, retaining of the puborectal sling, other group saying we'll divide it, nothing happens. But what was the thing that Pinai introduced which he feels that has changed his results in PSRP?
The accuracy of delineating the muscle complex.
It's non-surgical. What did he do? What did their team do, and what do we also? I mean, we also practice that for everybody. That's the ball management program.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so that is an alternate. Yeah, alternate way of getting it. So which he introduced and stressed on it, so that gives rise to the problem of the pseudo continence or the continence through other this thing. The other thing, post-operative management. You mentioned about antibiotics, but other concept is the nil oral status. How long would you keep a nil orally? You mentioned about catheter, so nil orally.
Sir, nil orally, it is described for about 72 hours to up to 5 days. Different authors. Some reports are saying within up to 48 hours is sufficient now.
No. Standard, you see, describe standard PSR.
5 days.
So in, 5 to 7 days with TPN. That's what would be described. And the car constipating diet, if that is what is needed. Yes. Yeah. As regarding LARP, you mentioned about that MRI functional. What actually do you mean by that? Did you understand the concept, or what was when you said about MRI use in LARP? What's the problem with LARP when you do LARP?
Sir, They say direct visualization of it can be done from the superior aspect. However, from the perineal aspect, only 1 centimeter incision is.
No, basically, if you conceptualize it as a curve in a LAR, what happens is when you're doing LARP, it comes vertically straight down. So you get
Straight
a straight down. So when you're
down.
doing an MRI, they're able to map it and give a curve so that some group maintains that it improves the contour rather than you are seeing the levator from below, perineum from, I mean, levator from above and perineum from below, and they join the 2 points. It becomes a straight line like that.
Something
Instead of that, they would go all around, manage the curve, use the MRI, and to maintain the curve or better symmetrical distribution, because symmetrical distribution in LARP is found to be more asymmetrical compared to PSR, which you mentioned. So to get that, they use functional MRI to get a curve and place it into the rectum. That's it. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. I'll open it for discussion, sir. If there is. Yes, sir.
Sorry.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Since most of the procedures are done
Yes, sir.
after the colostomy, that is somewhere around 4 to 6 months of age,
Yes, sir.
in the current context of things, an MRI is mandatory for high or intermediate fistula.
Yes, sir.
Many times we have found that one half of the levetiraceae has hypoplastic.
True, sir.
We are always under the impression both are well developed or
Yes, sir.
partially developed. Many times we have encountered one levetiraceae, one half is well developed, the other half is hypoplastic.
Yes, sir.
More so if there is sacral deformities.
Okay, sir.
Wherever there is a high or intermediate variety rectoprostatic or rectovestibular fistula,
Yes, sir.
sacral anomalies come into play,
Yes, sir.
which also will reveal tethered cord syndrome.
Yes, sir.
And we all assume that there is levetiraceae and then we do it.
True.
So it will reflect upon the constipation of the patient subsequently in the postoperative period.
Yes.
So important to know the anatomical structure of sacrum and the prognosis so that you know really whether in spite of the best location and best stimulation, centering, etc.,
Yes,
the
sir.
outcome, as Pina said in his own recent report,
Yes, sir.
25% are constipated and some are incontinent.
Yes, that's true, sir.
That aspect has to be taken into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, that's a
Thank you.
that has been the reason people group have tried MRI, as you mentioned, the associated nerve bone anomalies or nerve lesions can made out. But pertaining to the sphincter, they find it difficult to map it preoperatively. They can postoperatively, once the bowel is pulled down, they know whether it is symmetric, asymmetric, or, and that too with difficulty. But preoperatively, uniformly, beyond the levator, not able to get adequate data as to say what is a good muscle complex or not. Again, because there has been variation as what constitutes the muscle complex. So there is a debate on as to what constitute the muscle complex. Is it the vertical or is it just the slings? But that's true, sir. As you said, if there is a muscle hypoplasia, this thing and that, that will definitely alert us to towards the outcome of the child. Following a pull-through procedure. Yes. Any questions? Hello? Sorry, I'm not able to. Hello.
Hello, sir. Yes, sir.
Any more any questions or
Rohit has a question, sir.
Sir, in lower arms and all, generally we'll be having constipation because it's a dilated colon that causes hypomotility colon and all.
Okay.
So can't we pull down that colon and resect like so that I mean like tampering so that we can prevent that constipation?
lower RM, what is the reason for this one? What is the present theories for? Again, depends what you are doing. You are doing, you know, plastic. Would you want to answer that, Vidya, or is?
Not so sure, sir.
Okay, if it's low RM, what is the dip? What procedure would you say is it causing constipation? Is it with relation to enoplasty, just YB enoplasty, or is it in relation to doing a limited PSRP as being described by some group?
Anoplasty is causing constipation, sir. In limited PSRPs and all, there is so not much constipation reported, but the constipation is still reported in limited PSRP also, like in vestibular fistulas and all.
Yes, if you look through, if we, also recently we did that this inguinal transposition where we documented, yes. If you had see, show you the pictures probably subsequent to this one. In all this group, though it is low, low ARM, we have to understand that anteriorly there is a deficit in the muscle complex, so perineal body. So when we do anoplasty, it is always posterior. It's always, yes, posterior. We are not if you do a PSRP, you lifted the fistula away, you're reconstructing the anterior perineal body, and then placing the bowel and reconstructing the posterior, the sphincter complex. Whereas if you look at low RMs, since it's almost we don't know what's happening anterior to the bowel. So that is one of my hypotheses. That's the only thing, is because a couple of cases where we have seen the muscles diverging and not addressing this going back then, though the complex is good, the muscles are well developed, these children have come back with constipation. So that is one of the possible causes why they continue to have a constipation even after having development completely, because anteriorly the muscle complex is not developed, the perineal bodies are separate. So that's one of the reason. The other reason what they mention is that again in theory is the persistence of the internal sphincter complex, which are detached and they can have constipating effect on the terminal bowel. That's why the group from PINA group, they disconnect it and do a limited PSRP and do it. Of course, post-operatively, they put them on bowel management. It's very difficult to say whether it has worked or not worked till. But getting the bowel down, not necessary, because as you mentioned in previous surgeries, the dilated capacitive rectum and the neural filaments are much required. So we can't cut them off, and because that is also part of continence. So there are many factors to continence. One is the nerve and muscle, the bowel, the rectum available, and the movement. So these are all together had to continence. So we can divide them and go bring them up. But we'll probably have to look into this muscle factors itself as causes for this and try to address that and prevent this occurring. I think Ramchandra sir is there maybe.
Thank you, sir.
Most, I need David to tell me whether we have time or we need to. Time, okay. Is there adequate time, sir?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Oh. Yes, sir.
Okay. See, the constipation issue is a problem with the low ARMs, as Rohit was pointing out. Yes, for that, sir. He was suggesting that we take care of the dilated rectum. So that is a sort of a some sort of a crazy idea, what I would say, and it's dangerous. Okay, so that rectum, when you try to resect and dissect and remove it, you are going to damage everything and finish off the child's future forever. Okay, so constipation is a better evil to have than an incontinence.
Yes, exactly.
Yes,
and usually continence is managed in low RM by an aggressive dilatation program. And an aggressive management of constipation by some sort of a bowel management program, but modified to our societal situation with the use of diet, fluid, and bowel management program involving bowel washouts and enema. So aggressive dilatation program is very, very essential in low ARNs, especially in low ARNs. And then Pina and his group have presented a very characteristic problem which occurs in low ARNs, where they have a mega sigmoid. Yeah. So in that mega sigmoid variant, you will have to do a sigmoidectomy for them. You can do it laparoscopically or open. And if you do the sigmoidectomy in them, many of them, majority of them, the constipation goes away. You can manage the constipation better.
Yes, sir.
So in ARMs, low ARMs, constipation is a problem. It has to be managed by aggressive dilatation program and management of the diet, the fluid intake of the child, and also toilet training of the child, and usage of enema and other washouts. That is very important. And Vidya, SMC stands for striated muscle complex, not sphincter muscle complex. Okay.
Yes, sir. Okay.
It's called a striated muscle complex. That's the terminology, SMC.
Okay, sir.
Okay. And in low ARM in females, I usually use ASARP. I use ASARP.
Yes, sir.
Then there is another technique described by Chittisale and Rama Jayanti and all, which can be applied to rectovestibular fistula. It is called as the ASTRA approach, which they use for
cloacal malformation, sir.
Yes, yes. UG sinus, management of UG sinus.
Yes, please.
So it is a better approach compared to the PSARP. And also for UG sinus, it's a better approach compared to the approach of Pina, which is the TUM. So TUM, I don't usually agree with, and most people don't agree with TUM.
Yes.
That's what I found, because TUM gives rise to a lot of problems. Most important one is which makes a child who is dry urinary wise into a wet child.
Yes.
So that is a disastrous consequence of TUM.
Yes.
So many authors, what they do is they don't do anything for UG sinus and address it later by taking care of the vaginal portion as a separate entity later.
Yes, sir.
That's why, sir, I told not to do cloaca today, because that would
it will involve a full class.
Full class. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Dr. Raju Savji is also there, so I think we can listen to his. Raju?
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Oh, good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir. I just want to talk about because I missed a few minutes in between.
Yes, sir.
Are we supposed to include perineal canals also in this?
No.
Termination of
No, she has not talked about perineal canal. She has not talked about H type of fistula.
Ones which we are not to discuss today, sir.
I don't have to add anything.
Yes, sir.
But I would be interested to know what is the really difference between perineal and anal transposition and anterior sagittal canal.
If it is anal transposition, same again, this is what preserving the muscle without splitting it. In ASARP, you'll be cut to the rectum, level of rectum. Whereas in anal transposition, if where there is a normal developed anus seen in ectopic position, you can retain that. It will be, one will be dissection around the fistula, around the anus. And then other will be at the neo-anus, and it will be transposed back, like as in a Mollard's technique or as in Stephen's technique on the other way. That was partially this anteriorly. You are in ASRP, you are splitting the muscle like to the level of the rectum. That's the only the difference.
Is it theoretical, or it sounds very difficult to understand how without dividing it, even in perineal anal transposition.
Yeah,
You can do that.
You would want to show you some images. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Some,
put up the images, sir. Sir, I'm putting up the images. Is it visible, sir?
Yeah.
Okay.
This was okay. Yeah, this was the last one we did. Yes. But I think you should put the video so that they can appreciate the.
Yes,
the maybe we can send. Sir, the Rajan sir, the video which shows the contraction, and then see, it's very, very much. It is like a combination of both. Only the amount of muscle which you won't be splitting would be of order of about 1 cm or 2 cm. That's all. So depending on how well the muscle is developed, or you may end up going up doing an ASRP. If the muscle complex is developed, yes, you can save to an order of about 1 to 2 cm. This is, yeah, that's basically the dissection of that. Yeah, that around that would be that. Yes, as you truly said, it would be just about a centimeter or so of muscle which you are not split it. That's the only thing. Rest of part it would be remain the same.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. If there are no further questions, we will close. Thank you, Dr. Vidhi, for the.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
An excellent one. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very nice. Very good coverage.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.